celebration, commemoration of our beloved friend, Michael Judge. And Michael Judge loved to gather with groups of friends here in this place, friends in recovery, and share stories and hear stories. And in the exchange, all were lifted up and healed and moved on our journey together, delighting in one another. And so, it's fitting that we come back to this place and we do what Michael did here along with friends. We're here to tell stories, to lift each other up. And so I say to you, if I humbly might say such, Fáilte roimh go léir in Anna Mícheál. Welcome everyone in my...
Now, my name is Malachy McCourt, and I will be sort of moving things along this evening. I was thinking about Michael Judge, and I was wondering what happened when he got to his final destination there and walked in and was looking around, and this deity came by and said, "Can I help you?" And Michael said, "Well, I don't know where I am or how I got here." And God said, "Well, let me have a look here in the ledger." Yes, he said, "What's your name?" And he says, "Judge." Ah. And the first name, Michael, M-Y-C-H-A-L. Oh, that's an odd spelling. Ah, well, he said, every Tom, Dick, and Harry spells it the other way. And so he said, I'm often called Judge too, said God. "Are you?" says Michael. "What's your first name?" "Almighty." "Oh." Jesus, you must be from Texas or Kerry. "Now I tell you," he said, God says to him, you're in heaven, by the way." "Oh, I am." "What sort of a job would you like up here?" "Well, I'd like to tend to the sick if I could." "Well, we don't have any of them up here. Everybody is well, thank you," God says. "Well, how about fires?" "We don't have any of them here either. But I tell you, the one I know of," says God, "is quite far away. And it's eternal and it's untended." "How is that?" says Michael. "Well," he said, "because all the firefighters are here in heaven. And we don't tell them about that fire, else they'd be down there trying to put it out." We're all here for many reasons, for ourselves, for Michael, for whatever spiritual beliefs we have. But it would be nice if we could introduce ourselves to another person that we don't know. And if you feel romantic, you can give them the telephone number as well. So yeah, so do that. Introduce yourselves.
A really brief encounter, and while he was giving mass rites to to a fireman, and he was killed. People wanted to know what happened to him. Well, there's that famous picture in Newsweek in which they're carrying out Father Judge. As they're carrying him out, they placed him for a period of time on the corner of Church and Vesey Street. I was running down Vesey Street to the corner of Church. When I get down there, and I saw a man on the ground with his head covered. And as I got there, I see this Lieutenant William Cosgrove. And he's screaming at the top of his lungs, "Can somebody get this man a priest? Can somebody get this man a priest?" And I went up to the lieutenant. I said, "Lieutenant, is he a cop? Who is he? He's the fire department chaplain." So I said, "I know where there's a church." So I ran up to down north on Church Street into St. Peter's. When I ran into St. Peter's, I saw a lady, a blonde-haired lady, and I would like to meet the lady. Because the lady was ripping up sheets to give his, to cover up, because the smoke was so thick that nobody could breathe. And she told, I'm like, "Is there a priest around here? Is there any priest?" And she's like, "No, but if you're Catholic, you can do last rites." So upon hearing that, me being I've never gotten over the rank of altar boy, I wasn't too sure if I was ready for this promotion. But she told me this in a bit of shock. I ran back and I told the lieutenant. The lieutenant looked at me in the same face. But we ended up getting on our knees in the middle of this madness. We started praying. And to hold his hand, to hold his leg, to say a prayer for him. When, I'm not sure if anybody else was watching, there were people running around, but it was just the three of us, me, the lieutenant, and the father. And after we prayed, we got up, me and the lieutenant looked at each other, pat each other on the back, and we continued pulling people out of the building. And then the second building had collapsed. And seeing that building move, people scream, and the radio, the police radio is screaming, "Get out, the building's moving, get out, get out, get out," and the building's coming down on top of you. You try to run, and you can't run, because it's on top of you. And the smoke covered me, and I was rolling on the ground, and I could not breathe, and I couldn't see. The only thing I was happy about was that I prayed. I was in, at least I prayed, and I thought I was dead. I kind of feel that maybe the fall of that region then.
I met Father Michael at Siena College, and I knew him when he was living in the dormitories. And that was back in the day when he decided he would look good with his hair permed. I want you to close your eyes for a minute and imagine Father Michael goes disco. It was a sight. There's so many memories and so many stories that we can all tell, but you know, we all know what a hero he was, but there's a story that I just think captures his spirit and stands out for me. Several years ago, I was moving to Los Angeles, and my family was throwing me a party on the Upper East Side of Manhattan. It was the middle of July. It was outside. Everybody was hot, sweaty. I mean, just pouring. Nobody looked cute. There was nobody looking cute at this party. And in walks Michael with his hair perfectly coiffed. His, not a bead of sweat on his brow, and his robe and sandals. My best friend looks at him and turns to my mother and says, "Oh, leave it to the Willises to have the stripper dressed as a friar." So my friend Jarrett marches over. So my mother says, "Yeah, go ahead, Jarrett, go over and talk to him." So Jarrett goes over and starts playing with the belt, you know, doing the whole thing. And, Michael, and she asked, you know, if he was a stripper, and as you can imagine, Michael with those that mischievous smile and those dancing eyes, let her believe it just long enough to make it one of his favorite stories. In my work, I've met star athletes, kings and queens, literal and figuratively, presidents and movie stars. And what these people all have in common with Michael is that when you know, you're around these charismatic people, they all have that way of making you feel like you're the only one. The big difference between them and our hero Michael is he'd make you feel that way, and he would mean it. Like all of us, I've been struggling the last few weeks to try to make sense of this all, as an American and as a person, but mostly trying to make sense of the world without my Michael, because he was my Michael. And therein lies the beauty of Michael Judge, because he was my Michael, he was your Michael, he was your Michael, he was your Michael. And the gift that he gave each and every one of us is that he gave us exactly what we needed at the time we needed it most. He said my mother's funeral in April, and along with the usual things that had all the fallen away Catholics crying in the aisles, he turned to me and my 9 siblings, and he looked at all of us and said, "The most important thing for you is to keep this family together." He said, "I've seen too many families go their separate ways when the heart of the family is gone." And he repeated, "Keep this family together." As I look out at all of you tonight, this gathering of so many different branches of Michael's family tree, I hope that all of us keep on reaching out to respect each and every one of us whom he touched and to whom he has brought us together tonight. Let's keep this family together.
Father Michael came into my life when my family and I needed him the most. 10 years ago, this October 19th, I lost my brother Artie to AIDS. 6 weeks after that, my younger brother Willie also passed. As you can imagine, my family was heartbroken and grief-stricken. So in order to begin healing, to have closure, and to show how much we valued my brother's lives, we decided to have a memorial service. This was so important to my family, especially my brother John, who was not only Arthur's twin, but also suffering with the AIDS virus. As many of you know, in 1991, there were many, many prejudices towards AIDS. And we met many of them. As Memorial Day neared, we still haven't had anyone to officiate the service. It was very difficult to find someone who would be sympathetic to my family's needs. A friend of my brother John spoke to Father Michael. He immediately understood our pain. Without knowing us personally, without any hesitation, without any thought to how far he would have to travel, because I live out in Long Island, Father gave up his personal time and came to us to help validate my brother's lives. Not to mention he also stops in Jamaica to pick up Brendan along the way. Father Michael came in, he said Mass, he gave a eulogy. It was so unbelievable. We felt like we knew him forever. After the Mass, Father started to sing God Bless America. And I thought to myself, God bless America? This is a memorial service. But okay, why not? And within a few seconds, everybody in the room was singing. All right, it worked. After the tragedy of September 11th, I reflected back on that moment. And I said, gee, how symbolic is that? When it was nearing time for Father Michael to leave, after he prayed with us, after he sang with us, after he blessed us, he turned towards me and he said to me, I want to thank you so much for letting me be a part of your day. That was the type of man Father Michael was. During the service, Father Michael said some wonderful things, but there were certain things he said that touched me deeply. So tonight I would like to read a quote from Father Michael. Sometimes in life, when we lose someone we love, and we don't know what to do, we should just pray and worship. Thank you, Lord, for their lives, for their love, creativity, for their friendship. Yes, for their good days and their bad, for their happiness, for their anger, for everything they brought into our lives. I love you, so just love each other the best you can. God bless you, Father Michael.
Hi, my name's Larry. I knew Father Michael from the early 90s through working with the People with AIDS Coalition. It was another time with too many funerals and memorials. Father Michael was there for those who needed him. And as he was one of the few priests ministering to people with AIDS, that was quite a few people. So in January of 1993, when the end of this life was drawing near for Ron, my partner of 18 years, we too called him Father Michael, and he was there for us. He came to our apartment, talked, listened, understood, and administered the sacraments. As my dear friend Mary recalls, he anointed Ron's eyes, ears, hands, and feet very gently and lovingly. When it came time for communion, he broke bread, helped Ron take it in his hands, then bent over, picked Ron up from his wheelchair, and held him in his arms and rocked him. He held him to his chest for several minutes, then kissed him and set him back in the chair. It was clear that Father Michael had answered one of Ron's questions, "Is God angry with me?" And it was no. He was there for us when we needed him.
I met Father Michael Judge in the hospital when he came to visit a very good friend of mine, whose name is Valentin Vicente Vanegas, who died on September 26th of 2000. And prior to my friend's death, I met him in the hospital when he was visiting my friend Val, and they talked. I kind of, you know, shunned away from the conversation because it didn't have anything to do with me. But when he finished talking, he came up to me and he said, "Listen, Roberto, I want to tell you something. I don't care what you have done from the day you were born up until today, and up until today and the day you die, but for what you have done for your friend Valentino, you're going to heaven." And that was very special to me because no one has ever spoken that way to me.
I too was wondering what that first day in heaven was like for Michael. And one thing I know, he looked around and he said, "This is marvelous. It looks good. It's very nice. But there's no Brooklyn Bridge. There's no Chinatown. And I miss my friends." And if he could say one thing tonight, he'd say, "Where the hell is your habit and your sandals?" I'd say, "Well, I ran from the office and didn't get a chance to go home." "You're always running. Slow down. Slow down." This was from a man, the only man I know in my life who burned out an answering machine every year. It glowed as if it had radiation in it. But that was Michael. Michael he taught me how to be a man. And he fathered me in the most kind ways. He taught me how to be a friar. And he taught me how to be a priest. And I'm humbled by what I hear this evening. And not surprised, but humbled, because no one, it would seem to me, could ever fill his shoes. But that's not what Michael would say. Michael would say, "You remember what Jesus taught us? You think I've done great things? Far greater are the works you shall do." And I think how all of us have been touched by his life and his actions and his kindnesses. Maybe we can go out and we can do the same to others. He showed us how to do it. And it's not hard when you stop and think about it. It's taking people where they're at, and it's not being afraid of getting your hands dirty. I'm not used to preaching from the sanctuary because he taught me not to preach from the sanctuary. And I don't live my priesthood in the sanctuary because he didn't live his priesthood in the sanctuary. When you walk down there, you take a lot of risks and you put your life on the line in many ways. And Michael did that. And he did that for a lot of you. What he loved most in his life was being a friar and his priesthood. And he was a consummate priest. Because a priest, with his maturity and wisdom, knew that you lay down your life for anybody. And he did that for many of you in the program. He did that for his gay brothers and sisters at the risk of losing that which he thought was most precious to him. He didn't flinch in telling a family whose 16-year-old son was coming out that he too was gay, because he didn't want that kid to do harm to himself or to grow up in shame. He did that for a young friar many years ago. My coming out experience was with Michael at Service Merchandise. We were at a gathering for friars and we bought some little hoop earrings. And we got our ears pierced to celebrate my coming out today. He said, "Now we'll go to dinner with the friars." And I walked into a room with a big hoop in my ear. There were 200 priests in there. And he had taken his out. He was wonderful. And Michael's words, "Let's pray for one another. And remember, far greater are the works you shall do." That's what Michael would tell us tonight.
Some awards to Irish people living in America, and he was accompanying Patrolman Stephen MacDonald that evening, and we had a few words because I am a parent of four children and two of them have cerebral palsy. The next time I bumped into Father Judge was in Queens at an Irish parade. And Hillary Clinton was at that parade, and two of my children were there. And it was a freezing, freezing cold day. And my daughter was getting quite cold, and Father Michael came over, and I said, "Oh, my daughter's getting a bit chilly. And I looked down at his feet and the bare feet, and he held my daughter's hand and said, you know, don't think about the cold, and you'll see how if you don't think about it, you really won't feel cold. And at that moment, it had been cloudy and a nice day, but the sun came out, and effectively, she forgot all about the cold. He was a saintly man.
We want to celebrate Michael's entire life, not just his fire department ministry, not just his ministry as a Franciscan, or this ministry or that ministry. I'd like to just mention Michael's ministry to the homeless. It's kind of hard to find homeless to come to a memorial service. So during Michael's wake, this woman is very distraught. She was very disheveled. And she said, I just don't know how I'm going to go on without him. He helped me in so many ways that I just don't know how I can go on. But on the way over here to the wake tonight, she said, I helped somebody. And when I did that, I thought of Father Mike. And it made me feel good. Because that's what he did for me. So my way of remembering Michael is to do something good for somebody else. And that's how I'm going to get through.
I went to the Irish Odd Center about 13 years ago for a gathering of the Irish and a fundraiser. When someone asked me if I wanted a drink, and I said, I don't drink. And Michael Judge was standing next to me, and I didn't know him at the time. And they inquired of him, would you like to have a drink, Father? And he said, I don't drink. And I turned to him and I said, how come you don't drink? And he said, I have an allergy to alcohol. And I said, are you a friend of Bill's, founding member of Alcoholics Anonymous? And he shook my hand, said yes, and gave me a big hug. We became instant friends and buddies. It was not too far after that that he became the chaplain of the New York City Fire Department. And there was a terrible fire on Watt Street in the village. And it was my brother's firehouse, Engine 24. And when I woke up in the morning, I put the TV on and I heard the news and saw them carrying out several injured firemen. I said, oh my God, my brother Bob. And I called the house and my brother answered the phone and he said, I was off last night. It was the captain and two of the kids. But I was most grateful that my brother Bob was alive and that God had spared him. And I said to Father Michael, I'd like to come and see you. I'd like to return to the flock. And he said, come up, meet me at the house. And I come up to 31st Street. And he took me into his office and we sat down and we chatted and I told him my story. And he blessed me. He gave me absolution. And I said, Father, thank you for giving me absolution. And he said, I didn't give you absolution. Give it to yourself. I loved Michael Judge more than I ever loved any other man in my life. And I told that to my wife, Barbara, many, many times since his death. No man has ever touched me as Michael Judge touched me. Oh, how we're going to miss him. And oh, how we loved him.
I will rise and go now and go to in a tree, in a small cavern there, there of clay and wattles made. Nine green rows will I have there, and hive for the honeybee, and walk while in the beloved lane on the Isle of Finisfree.
Only Father Mike could do this. We get Irish music. I don't use this word very often. Gay people and friends of Bill's together in a room.
Summon the priests in our parish. They would speak to the elderly, and some would speak to the little kids, and some would speak to the people with families. But Father Mike, his words touched everyone.
I'm from the period where, you know, first people would die the next day, and then it was, you know, a few weeks, and then there was a period where it was a year, and then 2 years, and then a few years. And, you know, during that whole period, you know, I was one of the people that thought, gee, you know, I'm probably going to go. And I had always had it in my mind that I would ask, that I would want him to say the funeral mass, because I thought what a great comfort he would be to my family.
He was able to touch the part of you that was lost in shame and in pain, and those are two of my favorite emotions.
The thing I'll remember most about Father Michael is how much he loved us all and how well he loved us. He loved us so well.
Michael, in very subtle ways or in very grand ways, touched so many people that by, at the point of his death, I think he just exploded into stars. He became so much a part of the universe and who we are that I feel that I can call on Michael even more now, because I know I won't get his answering machine.
Judge spent every one of 40 biblical days with John Drennan, as John Drennan was trying to stay alive. And there was one time I saw him lay those beautiful priest's hands he had on maybe one place in John Drennan that didn't hurt him to touch. And he said a very simple prayer. And he basically just said that, God, I know you're here, and I know John Drennan is a good man. And then a single tear rolled down John Drennan's cheek. And I have to say that I thought I was seeing God right then. 3 days after that, Drennan's wife said, you can go, John, it's okay. And then she looked at Michael Judge, and he nodded. And then John Drennan left. And he said the Mass at St. Patrick's Cathedral. I'm not entirely sure the Cardinal was thrilled with that. And he turned St. Patrick's Cathedral into a little Irish country church. And it was all of a sudden this very close, intimate place. And he knew exactly what to say to Vina Drennan, the wife. But more importantly, he knew exactly what to say to the kids. And we all went out to Staten Island. We stood by the grave. And as Michael Judge said, the Our Father, a butterfly landed on the flowers. And after that, he said to Vina Drennan, "You see, Vina, all is well." And she looked at him like he was nuts. I remember him once saying to the Drennan kids, "My God is the God of surprises." And I think what he meant by that is that in the most terrible moments, you can start to see remarkable things. And I think all of us in the days that follow, in the midst of that terrible thing downtown, we started to see remarkable things in people. At his funeral, Vina Drennan came in, and she had 15-month-old grandson, Drew. And she was sitting there, and she was looking at Drew in her lap. And she said, "You know, Michael, all is well."
I had met Michael in life. I more or less kept my distance from Michael Judge because I knew that Michael was a gay man and he was a priest. And I'm also a gay man and head of a organization of gay firefighters and EMS workers. And I never wanted to intrude upon his relationship with his church or in any way get him in trouble. On the morning of September 11th, as thousands of other firefighters were attending or converging on the area where the Trade Center was, I was down there too with a group of firefighters. And in the first of, I believe, two messages that I got from Michael Judge after his death, we were heading down Church Street and we came upon St. Peter's Church. And at the time, when we were down there, it's very hard to describe. People ask you to describe what was going on down there. And in the last couple of days, I've thought about it, and it was such a devastating sight. And there was this dust and smoke in the air, and there was no color to anything. Everything was just this gray, just a non-color. And we came upon St. Peter's Church, and some other firefighters were standing there, and they said, "The fire department chaplain is inside." And I said, "Makes sense. The fire department chaplain would set up his outpost in a church, and he would come out to as we needed, or we could go into him." And in the second breath, the gentleman told me that the chaplain was dead, and literally felt like my knees got weak. And I asked which one it was, and he said, "Michael Judge." So at that moment, we all just stopped and were stunned, and we said that we had to go inside and pay our respects to him. And in a world that looked completely gray and dark, we walked up the steps of the church and opened the doors, and there was color. The inside of the church had color. We started walking up the center aisle, and we could see the dirty footprints from the other firefighters who had come in, who carried him in there, and we saw some blood on the aisle. And we got up to the front of the altar, which was much like this. It's a beautiful old church, St. Peter's. And there laying before the altar was the body of Michael Judge. And it was an incredibly, incredibly beautiful sight. It was very sad. It was everybody knelt and cried. But it was an incredibly beautiful sight. He laid there, very peaceful looking. He was covered in a sheet. He had his badge and his ID card on his chest. And he has religious stole folded beautifully over his legs. And in a horrendous moment, it was a beautiful sight. It also sent a clear message to me of what the devastation was going to be that day, and seeing our fire department chaplain laying there dead. And we said a quick prayer, we cried for a second, we got up, and we had to leave the building and go look for our people. The second time that I believe Michael Judge sent me a message was the morning he was being buried from St. Francis of Assisi. That morning,
that whole first week of this incident, we were pretty isolated in just going down to the site and working it, and just so worried about our fellow firefighters and the people we lost. We lost five people from my house alone. As you know, the tremendous loss that we experienced from the whole day. But that morning, that was one of the first times I had read an article that was written by some supposed reverends, Jerry Falwell and Pat Robertson, that blamed the events of September 11th on gay and lesbians. And I was furious, and I was just did a little ranting and raving in the kitchen of the firehouse, and then got my act together and went upstairs, got my uniform on, and went to St. Francis to pay my respects to Michael Judge. And as I was standing there in front of the church, the pallbearers from the firehouse next to me had carried his body out of the church and down the steps and then over in front of the firehouse, turned around and started heading back to the church. And then right in front of me, they faltered for a moment, and it seemed like they were going to drop the casket, so I just jumped out and grabbed onto the casket. And the fellow who was standing there jumped to the side. And it was such a message to me that here these people were trying to blame gays and lesbians. And here I was, a gay firefighter, and I was carrying my gay priest for his final trip through his church. And it was an incredible message, and if anybody can take anything from the September 11th act, you need to take the fact that everybody counts. The world is a beautiful place. There is color in it. And that, you know, in the future, we will never forget any of the people we lost. And one day we'll all be laughing in front of the firehouses again.
One more time.
every day as if it's going to be your last, and one day you'll be right. God bless you.
There's a reception which you're all very welcome to join.